Okay, so I think we will start for the morning talk. So it's a pleasure to welcome Emily Chouzenou from Marne-la-Vallée, Paris-Est, and also INRIA. And Emily will speak about optimization method for large-scale problem.
Thank you. So indeed, I will present an efficient family of optimization algorithms to solve problems involving a large number of variables. So this kind of difficult problem can arise in many applications in machine learning, signal, image processing, telecommunication. In this talk, I will mainly focus on the resolution of inverse problems arising in image processing. And I will present MM algorithms, so majorization, minimization algorithm, with acceleration strategies based on subspace for solving this kind of problems. So let me first introduce the notion of inverse problems and give some notation I will use in this talk. So in inverse problems, the goal is to find an estimate of an image, a signal, a video of interest from a degraded version of it. The degradation usually came from the acquisition process and can be usually modeled as follows. So if X bar denotes the original image, the input data is Y equal DHX bar, where H models the observation model. So for example, it can model a blur, a projection, a Fourier transform. And D aims at modeling some noise degradation, something more random, which can appear so from the acquisition or from some uncertainty. Uncertainties we have on the model H. So the aim in the context of inverse problems is to find an estimate X hat of X bar, knowing Y and the model H. And I recall that we are in the context of large scale problems, meaning that the dimension N here and M here are very large. So typically more than 1 million of variables. An efficient strategy, very general strategy to solve such kind of inverse problem is to reformulate it as an optimization problem. This is why we need good optimization methods. So what is the function we need to minimize? The function reads as follows, as a sum of two terms. The first term is what I call the data fidelity term. So the data fidelity term measures the adequation between the data Y and the model HX. And usually the shape of the expression of F is related to the statistical model we have on the noise. So for example, if we have some Gaussian assumption on the noise, it's usual to adopt F as a least square term, but other functions can be used for other types of noise. And the goal of the function psi, called the regularization function, is to add some a priori information we have on the solution in order to make this problem more robust to the noise and to the fact that matrix H is usually a very yield condition. So we'll add some a priori, some constraints we have on the solution. So here I give some examples. I will give other examples in the next slides. For example, we can have some sparsity assumption on X, or more generally on FX, where F can be a decomposition operator, for example, in a frame domain, in a wavelet basis, etc. So there is a need to solve this optimization model. The number of variables equals n, so we are in a very large dimension. And the choice of an efficient optimization algorithm highly depends on the mathematical properties of the functions who are involved, so typically f and psi. So in this talk, I will only focus on the case when these functions are differentiable. And I will present this family of MM algorithms. The idea behind this MM algorithm is to use, really deeply the properties, the structure of the functions who are involved in the optimization problem in the context of a differentiable optimization. So I will give the outline of this talk. So I will first present the, what I call the 3MG algorithm, so MM memory gradient algorithm, starting by introducing what is the principle behind MM and what is this subspace acceleration strategy. Memory gradient will be a special instance with a particularly good efficiency on a numerical example. So I will present two examples in the context of image reconstruction. And then I will have two other parts in my talk presenting two recent extensions of this 3MG method in the context of large-scale optimization. The first extension is what I call block parallel 3MG algorithm. The aim of this algorithm is to be able to use parallel computing devices in an efficient manner along with this 3MG algorithm. And the second extension is a stochastic 3MG algorithm, how to use this algorithm when the data are treated in an online manner. So let me start by introducing the concept behind MM algorithm. So MM algorithm, it's a quite old algorithm. You can find some quite old papers already in the 60s. The idea behind this MM is quite simple. We need to solve a complicated problem. We need to minimize this complicated function f. We will replace this complicated optimization problem by a sequence of simpler optimization problems. And these simpler problems will come from the notion of tangent majorant. So I will replace f by an approximation of it, which is tangent majorant to f. So what I mean by tangent majorant, so I am at a given point, x prime, and the approximation will need to be greater than f in every point and tangent to f at x prime. So it defines this concept of tangent majorant, and then a very generic algorithm called what we call MM algorithm is the following iteration. So xk plus 1 is defined as the minimizer of this majorizing approximation of f around the current point xk. So this is exactly what happens here in the scalar case. And of course, the we can see by construction that the sequence f of xk will decrease, which is already a good starting point to study the convergence of the algorithm, because we want to minimize f. And actually, there exist many convergence properties of this algorithm depending on the properties of f and q. But of course, what is important, especially in the context of large-scale optimization, is to have a low complexity per iteration. At each iteration, we need to solve an optimization problem. So we need to choose the approximating function in order to have a minimum complexity for this subproblem. And what will be the simplest choice? It will be to choose Q as a quadratic function. So this is what I will propose in this talk. So let me first give an example. I will use this example in all the remaining of the talk for the structure of function f. So f, I remind you that we have the data fidelity term and the regularization term. So I will consider this general form for the regularization term. So the first for the data fidelity term, I do not make too many assumptions. I just assume that f is Lipschitz differentiable with constant mu. And for the regularization term, so the aim of this term will be to introduce some sparsity assumption on the linear transform vsx minus small vs. So we can think for example, than in the context of image processing. For example, VS can be some gradient operator along the vertical and horizontal directions of the image, and it will introduce some kind of regularity assumption on the pixels of the on the neighbor's pixel of the image. But other choices are also possible. So I will make several assumptions on this function psi s. These assumptions may appear quite technical, but I will give in the next slide several examples of functions satisfying this assumption. Remember that my goal is to have psi s differentiable. I'm in the context of differentiable optimization. So typically, I cannot use the absolute value, the standard L1 sparsity prior, but I will use some kind of smooth approximation of this one. And what is also very important is that I'm not in the necessarily in the context of convex optimization. For the moment, I do not make any convexity assumption on the psi s. And this is also why I may need this quadratic term, especially in the non-convex case, in order to ensure the well definition, the well poseness of my optimization problem, the existence of minimizer when psi s is non-convex. So let me have a look on possible examples for psi s. So this is typically typical choices possible for psi s. So here I plotted three different types of functions. So in blue you have the typical differentiable approximation of the absolute value. So this is what I call the L2 L1 function, because near zero we have a quadratic behavior and at infinity we have a linear behavior. But other choices are also possible. You have this function, the log 1 plus t squared, which has a quadratic behavior near zero and a logarithmic behavior at infinity. And in red, you have what I consider as a differentiable approximation of the L0 prior. So this function is non-convex. It behaves as a quadratic near zero and is constant at infinity. So typically, this one will have a behavior close to the L0 prior. So all these functions satisfy the previous assumptions. There are many other possibilities. So here I give you a list of possible convex functions. So all the four have the same kind of behavior than the blue one here. And you have other possibilities for the non-convex priors. So given this shape for the fog function f, we are able, using some classical properties of MM algorithm, to build the quadratic majorizing approximation of function f. So the general form of this quadratic majorant function is the following. Actually, because we have the tangency condition, it directly implies the following form for the quadratic majorant function. We can see that q xk xk equal f of xk. And the only parameter to set is a matrix A of xk. So matrix A of xk should be defined in order to satisfy the majorization condition, so that q is greater than f. So in our example, if we define A as a follow, we will have the majorizing condition which is satisfied. So here we recover this part which is related to the data fidelity term. So it's equal mu, remember it's the Lipschitz constant of the gradient of small f, times the linear operator, H transpose H, plus this term which are related to the majoration of the penalty, psi of X. So here this term was quadratic, so majorant of quadratic is itself. This is more interesting. We needed to majorize this sum of psi s of vs etc. And we can show that if we choose this term as follows, where v is the concatenation of all the matrices vs, and b is a vector defined as follows. So I remind you that nu s is defined as follows. So nu s of t, this is not the second derivative. We are not building the second order Taylor approximation because we need the majorization condition. If we choose nu s as follows, so psi prime of t divided by t, then we will have the majorization condition. So now we have built this quadratic approximation, and now we are able to build our MM algorithm to minimize a function f. There is a difficulty. At each iteration, we will need to minimize this quadratic function. Okay, we have an explicit solution. The problem is that we need to invert matrix A at each iteration, so the computational cost is very high. When n is 1 million, we have a 1 million times 1 million matrix to invert, so it's not a good candidate for solving large-scale optimization problem. So there have been several strategies in order to reduce the complexity of this quadratic MM method in the context of large-scale optimization. The first strategy was to invert in an approximated manner this A using, for example, few iterations of linear conjugate gradient. This is a possibility. Here I will propose an alternative, which is what I call subspace acceleration. Right. I will describe it in the next slide. So my proposal is the following. Instead of minimizing Q in the whole space, Rn, I will minimize it in a smaller space, which is defined as follows. So I construct a matrix Dk with n lines and mk columns. Typically, mk should be small. And I consider the space spanned by the columns of Dk. And so I will minimize xk within this space. So it means that I'm looking for the best linear combination of the columns of Dk in the sense of minimizing my quadratic function Q. So of course, if the spanning space corresponds to Rn, I go back to the standard MM quadratic algorithm. So in the context of the function f I have presented, it corresponds to what is known in image processing as the half quadratic algorithm proposed by Gehman and Reynolds. But here what I want to propose is another strategy, is to take mk small, eventually very small, in order to reduce the complexity of the method. And what I will propose more precisely is the following choice. So for Dk, I propose a matrix with one column when at the initialization and two columns when k greater than 1, and these columns are the following. The first column is simply the gradient direction, so I'm looking for the minimizer of my majorizing function in this gradient direction. I know that it's a good direction for optimization algorithm. And I also include some kind of memory. This is what I call this memory gradient. I look also in the past direction xk minus xk minus 1. So actually, what we'll do this step, it will create a linear combination between these two vectors and the weights. You will have two weights to compute. We will see the numerical update in the next slide. This weight will ensure that we are minimizing the quadratic function within this subspace. So actually, this idea of incorporating a memory in the algorithm is also present in many other optimization algorithms, such as nonlinear conjugate gradient, also the low memory version of BFGS, and also non-smooth optimization algorithms, such as FISTA and TWIST. So there is some hope that the method will work good. There are other possibilities for Dk. I will show some comparison a bit later. So the simplest one is the one I've presented, is the memory gradient. But we can think about adding more memory in our subspace. We can add xk minus 2 minus xk minus 3, etc. So this is what is called super memory gradient. We can also use, instead of having xk minus xk minus 1, why not using the past gradient? We can store them and minimize within this this subspace. And also there have been other subspaces proposed in the literature. The one proposed by Nemirovsky, which used a specific linear combination of all the past gradients. And also there is a subspace related to the quasi-Newton BFGS strategy, which consider the past directions and also the past difference of the gradients. So it's in order to mimic, in some sense, the LBFGS updates. So all these choices are possible for our MM subspace method. So let me rewrite the algorithm when I choose a 3MG subspace. So at each iteration, I need to compute the gradient of F in order to construct DK. If I am at the first iteration, I use DK equal minus the gradient. Else, I'm using minus the gradient, the path direction. And this is the update rule. So I need to compute this matrix. So this matrix, actually, it's a very small matrix. It's a 2x2 matrix when k is greater than 1. And I will compute my weights, my vector uk of dimension 2. And the update is the following, xk plus dk times uk. So we have seen that we highly reduce the complexity of the algorithm because instead of inverting a n by n matrix, we have inverted a mk times mk matrix. And basically, when mk equals to 2, it costs almost nothing. So know that there are all other complexity reductions who are possible depending on the structure of f. Because here, actually, the main cost is the product matrix A times the columns of DK. So we can make use of the recursive form of DK in order to reduce the complexity of this product by storing the previous product at the previous iteration, etc. So all this is detailed in the paper. So I will now present some kind of intuition between this algorithm I have proposed and existing methods in the literature. So I've already mentioned the conjugate gradient algorithm and the half quadratic and the quasi-Newton. What are the true links between all these methods? So some very interesting point is that if my cost function is quadratic and if I choose for the majorant the function f itself, actually, 3MG is exactly equivalent to the linear conjugate gradient. We do not gain nothing by adding this all this MM framework in the quadratic case. It's what is interesting is the non-quadratic case. In the non-quadratic case, actually, if we write down the update, 3MG is very similar to the non-linear conjugate gradient because we are making some linear combination between gradient and path direction. There is one important difference. The important difference is that in NLCG, you need to compute the conjugacy formula and then to search step size using some iterations. Here, you have directly some kind of closed form for the what I call conjugacy formula, but we do not really have some conjugacy property, and also for the step size. So we do not need any line search in this MM algorithm. Also, if we choose a subspace, the quasi-Newton subspace I've introduced in my previous table, what you obtain is some algorithm which is very close to LBFGS. The difference is that you have another way of constructing the approximation of the Hessian, which is based on MM and not on this BFGS update. And the second point is that here again, you do not have any line search. And finally, I've already told this, if you choose a space spanning the whole Rn, you go back to the classical half-quadratic algorithm. So I will now present some convergence theorem for the 3MG. So this is the results of two different papers. We first make the analysis in the convex case, and then we extend this result in the non-convex case, assuming some regularity assumption on F. Typically, we assume that F satisfies the KL inequality. So in the convex case, we have quite with a standard result for optimization in the differentiable case. So we have the convergence of the cost function, the gradient goes to zero, and we have, of course, when f is strongly convex, we have the convergence of the secants to the minimizer of the problem. The result in the non-convex case is much more original because we show in the non-convex case the convergence of the secants to a critical point. And this is very interesting because typically for nonlinear conjugate gradients, there does not exist such result. There is no result on the convergence of the iterates in the non-convex case. So the MM framework allows us to pursue the proof through the convergence analysis in this non-convex setting. So let me now present two examples of application of this method in the context of image restoration. So I first consider a very simple example of image denoising. The purpose of this example is to compare SWAMG with different approaches from differentiable optimization. And also we have made some comparison with discrete optimization based on graph cuts. We are also able to solve this type of problems. So these are the results. So yeah, we do not see many things. So I display here the error, the reconstruction error. So this is a result for the convex regularization, L2, L1 regularization. And here what was interesting is that if I'm using this time a non-convex penalty, I really improve the result. So you can see at the SNR, we gain more than 2 dB on the error of a reconstruction. So this really shows the interest of being able to treat this non-convex penalties. So let me now present the comparison. So we compare for the convex and non-convex penalty. So we compare with NLCG, LBFGS, and half quadratic. So we can see that we have a similar order of magnitude for SWAMG and LBFGS. We are a bit faster. NLCG in the convex case, it's quite efficient, but in the non-convex case, there are many numerical issues in this example. Half quadratic, even if the problem is not that big, 100 times 100 image, it's not a really big image, it's still much slower than the other methods. And finally, we make some comparison using the truncated L2 penalty. So truncated L2 penalty, we have a quadratic and then a constant shape. So it's very close to the L2, L0, but we can apply a discrete optimization method. So we compare with 4 discrete optimization methods, which are presented as follows, using the same type of implementation. So all this was programmed in C. And we can see that our method are much faster. And also, we do not lose in terms of reconstruction error by using L2, L0 instead of truncated L2. We have a similar quality of images at the end. Second example, so this SWAMG algorithm, we made the extension of the algorithm for complex-valued signal, and we apply this in the context of a parallel magnetic resonance imaging reconstruction. And so this is what we obtain. So here again, we compare convex and non-convex penalty. So in this case, VS corresponds to wavelet decomposition. So these are the results. So here we have a slight improvement with non-convex, is maybe less impressing. And we make also some comparison between our method in the convex case with other convex optimization approaches based on the L1 prior and proximal iteration. So we make comparison with ADMM, Chambol-POC, and primal dual algorithm. And we can see that SWAMG is has a very good performance on this example, and that using the smoothed L1 function, if we choose well the parameter of smoothing, at the end we can reach approximately the same SNR. So I have presented this algorithm to solve differentiable optimization algorithm. We have good results in several applications. But there is still a difficulty. We try to apply this problem for I would say, very large-scale problem. So not just large, but very large. Typically, video processing, 3D image reconstruction. And in that case, we are facing difficulties related to the memory requirement of the method. Typically, at each iteration, we need to store vector X, we need to store the gradient, we need to store matrix vector products, all this with dimension n. If n is very large, sometimes we cannot afford this storage. So I will propose two strategies in this context. So when the number of variables is very large, I will propose the block parallel approach. And when the number of the size of the data, so remember m is the number of lines in a matrix H, so it corresponds to the number of input data. When M is very large, or when M arises or must be treated in a streaming manner, I will propose a non-line strategy for this 3MG. So I will first present the block parallel approach. So the block parallel approach is based on the following idea. So at I will consider my vector of unknown, X. I will partition it into some blocks with possible different shapes. It just have to be a partition. And what I will do at each iteration, instead of applying the 3MG update on all the vector X, I will apply onto some blocks, a certain number of blocks that I will select. And my goal is to update these blocks, say for example four blocks, in a parallel manner using four processors. So there is a block approach, but it also should be combined with a parallel update strategy. So what is the advantage of such a strategy? We can control the memory just by choosing simply the number of blocks which will be updated at each iteration. And because we are updating the in a parallel manner, we can hope to reduce the computational time using a parallel computation device. So just be careful on this slide, and on the remaining of the slide regarding this method, I will not make any separability assumption on the cost function. So this is what is very challenging on this problem. I want something which which is efficient on parallel programming, but I do not assume any parallel structure in my problem initially. So I will introduce parallel structure through the strategy. So this was the first attempt to make some kind of block alternating 3MG. At each iteration, we select a block subset. So there are J blocks. We select a set S, possibly depending on the iteration. We find the quadratic majorant of my cost function with respect to these blocks. So in that case, it's not very difficult. We are already able to construct a majorant with respect to all the space, all the variables. We only need to consider matrix A and to select the lines and columns related to the blocks I have selected. So here, this is very simple. Once I have A, I have AS. And I apply the 3MG update on this block. So I minimize my majorizing function within the 3MG subspace, which is defined as follows. So this is a definition of 3MG for each block J. And for all the remaining blocks which have not been selected, I just let them constant. There is a problem with this strategy. So it's a block alternating strategy. We will have good convergence property. The problem is that there is nothing parallel in this algorithm. There is no parallel loop. So there is a very few chances to have this efficient on a parallel computing structure. Why? Because we have to invert this matrix within the 3MG subspace, and these matrices, they do not have any specific structure. They are just subpart of the initial matrix, but they are not necessarily block diagonal. We would like to have block diagonal matrices to be able to invert them in a parallel manner. So here there is nothing, it's not a parallel optimization algorithm, just block alternating. So my proposal is the following. I accept to have maybe a worse majorizing approximation, but I want that my curvature matrix or block diagonal. So I want to have some block diagonal approximation of these matrices to be able to create this parallel optimization algorithm. So this is the result we obtain. The proof is not so complicated, so it's based on the Jensen's inequality for convex functions. And what I am proposing is the following. So I consider a generic form for A of X. Typically, I assume that this is a sum of product between a matrix, I denoted them T, times diagonal matrix times T. So it's okay for my example. Remember, we have H transpose H plus V transpose diag V, so it takes this form. And for this kind of matrices, I'm able to construct a majorizing approximation, so in the sense of inequality between matrices, which is block diagonal, and each block is given by the following formula, and these weights are related to Jensen. So I have this block diagonal approximation of A, and then I will be able to create this block parallel 3MG. So this is the algorithm. So at each iteration, I'm selecting a subset of blocks in 1J. And then there is a parallel loop. So for each block in parallel, I'm computing the gradient with respect to this block, the majorant matrix with respect to this block using the previous formula, and this is exactly the 3MG update, but only in this particular block. So all this is done in a parallel manner. The other blocks remain a constant, and then there is a sharing operation between all cores, or I should be more precise, between all necessary cores. So I'm only doing sharing operation which are useful in order to be able to compute the gradient, for example, of block G with respect to XK, etc. So in particular, it's very important to limit this sharing operation to have a good numerical efficiency of the algorithm. Think about an image processing application. You have some regularization function between neighbors pixels. You only need to share information between these neighbors pixels. You always never need to share information between very distant pixels because they are not linked inside the cost function. So this is very important to be careful to this step. So this is the BP3MG algorithm, and I will present an application of this algorithm on a problem of a 3D image deconvolution with a space variant blur. So what does it mean? We have an input image, a 3D image, which is degraded by the observation process. So typically here it was a microscope, plus some noise. So y equals h x bar plus some additive noise, and h models a 3D convolution operator. So what does it mean? It means that this output image is blurred with a 3D blur, and we assume that the shape of the blur depends on the position of the pixel. But this is very common in microscopy, in every optical device, when you have optical aberration, and depending on the position of the pixel, if you are close or far from the optical center, you will have different blur effects in the image, and you need to take this into account in your observation model. So the difficulty is that in this context, especially in the context of 3D imaging, the just applying H to X is very costful. So it can be very interesting to apply H only to a subpart, to a block in this 3D volume. So this was for the detail regarding the parallel implementation. So it was done using MPI. And for the moment, we are using what I called master-slave implementation. So it means that we have one core which is dedicated to the main loop of the algorithm, selecting the blocks and deciding which cores should make the 3MG updates and which core should share with the other. and all the other cores are just performing the SWIFT-G updates on their own block. So this is what we done. So in our example, we are splitting the volume in slices, and each slave core has access to only a few small parts of slices, and at each iteration it will select one slice of the volume and make the update, and at the other iteration select another slice, etc. Here we have implemented it in a cyclic manner, so we have a loop inside each slave, and we will have exchanges between neighboring slices of the volume. So these are all the results. So this is one slice of the original degraded and restored image. This is first and second example. And for these two examples, we have looked at the acceleration bring by the use of multi-core architecture. So we have here the acceleration, so computation time divided by computation time for one core with respect to the number of cores, and we have good linear acceleration depending on the number of activating cores, knowing that the cost function was not separable. So we really have introduced a parallel structure thanks to this block diagonal majorizing function. So we have a good potential for parallelization with this block parallel method. So I will now go to the last part of my talk, which is based on a stochastic extension of the 3MG algorithm in order to solve stochastic optimization problem. So I will first introduce the type of problem we will solve. So here we will assume the following form. For F, we assume that what I call the data fidelity term, or the loss function, is a least square. And we have the regularization psi, which takes the same form as the one described earlier. So we have the following. We have an expectation of yn minus hn transpose x norm squared. Hn and yn now are random variables, random matrices and random vectors. And we have the following first and second order properties. That the expectation of the norm of yn square is equal to a constant rho, and small r and a big r for the other expectation. And we want to solve this optimization problem. So for the moment, we are restricted our case to the least square. So this type of problem can be encountered in inverse problems, typically when you have such a large data sets, such a large matrix H, that you will at each iteration only activate one part of the lines of these matrices to make the update. But we can also find some other applications. So of course in machine learning, in supervised classification, you have this type of problem, and also in system identification, etc. So the difficulty here is to solve this optimization problem knowing that we do not have access to the true function, because we cannot evaluate this expectation, and we only have access to the second order, some estimate of the second order statistics of Hn and Yn. So for this, I will propose the stochastic 3MG algorithm. So let me first have a look on the idea behind stochastic optimization. So in stochastic optimization, at each iteration, we will only have access to a stochastic approximation of F. So this approximation in the context of least square, it can be written as follows. So we replace the expectation by an empirical mean, and we have the sum for all the previous iterates of the quadratic loss plus the regularization function. Here it's a deterministic term. So we have this mean, and it's a quadratic function. We can write it as follows when we have rho n, small rn and big rn written as the following mean. We add something more in the method. We wanted to make the method adaptive to possible changes in the statistics. Typically, we are estimating an image, and suddenly there is a change in the solution. will the method be able to adapt itself and to shift to the other solution? So we introduce some forgetting factor, which was already proposed in the literature of adaptive filtering. And the idea is the following. You just add a forgetting factor in the sum here, and you divide it correctly by the good normalization factor. The forgetting factor is defined as follows, and it depends on the constant theta. So if theta equal to 1, we do not have any forgetting factor. And when theta decreases, is lower than 1, it's like the algorithm forgets about the past. And when theta increases more and more, it forgets more and more rapidly about the past iterates. Once we have the stochastic approximation Fn, we apply the 3MG strategy, meaning that we will construct a majorizing approximation not of F but of Fn. We only have access to Fn using the previous formula. So now the quadratic reads as follows. We have Fn. Here we have the stochastic approximation of the gradient of Fn, and here An. Here it's related to psi, so no changes. What changes is here we replace R by its approximation Rn. And second step, we minimize this majorizing approximation in the 3MG subspace, which is defined as follows. So we use, instead of the true gradient, we use this approximation of the gradient, and we use the past, again, the difference of the past iterates. Here we are adding a third vector in Dn because it will help us for the convergence analysis. Basically, it does not change many things. It just changes a bit the form of the update, but we can show that it's almost equivalent to the 3MG. So we add the current iterate in the subspace. And at last, when we have finished the update, we need to perform the standard recursive least square updates in order to modify this small r and big r, knowing the new input data yn. So this is quite standard. Here again, we can use different kind of subspace, not only 3MG, but we can use again, we can use more memory, we can use only gradient. And here I put what I call Nesterov subspace because it's well used, it's often used in the machine learning community, where this term is usually called the momentum term, so xn minus 1, this is a memory term. And in the Nesterov approach, we can add the difference of the previous gradients. So this is just another possibility for the subspace, so we can use also this strategy within the MM framework. So this is the algorithm we obtain. At each iteration, we update this estimate Rn, big Rn. We are able to compute the gradient of Fn. We choose, we select the subspace, 3MG or another subspace, and we perform the update, un, and then xn plus 1. So here we have this little change where xn plus 1 is only dn un because xn is already present in the subspace. So this is the only change with respect to the batch case. So this is the algorithm, and we propose another way of implementing this algorithm in order to reduce the complexity of the method. So we can implement it in a recursive manner. So this is the form of the algorithm, so it's not a very nice algorithm, but this is how you must implement it in practice to reduce the number of product matrix vectors and to have the best complexity of your algorithm. But this is equivalent to the previous form. So you see that we are storing product matrix vector with V0 and with a big V. So we have made a study of the complexity of the method for different cases, different choices of V. And what is, so I'm just showing you the result. What is very interesting is that when V equals to identity, so V, remember, is the linear operator involved in the regularization. When V equals identity and Q equals 1, Q, it corresponds to the number of data you update at each iteration. So we are updating only one term at each iteration. Then we find a complexity which is of the same order of the standard recursive least square algorithm. Recursive least square algorithm, it allows to solve only the least square problems without regularization. So it means that with 3MG, we do not increase the complexity if V equals to identity. And we can include the regularization, which is not the case of RLS. I will finish this for the theoretical part on S3MG with the convergence result. So we made some, we have several technical assumptions. The main assumption is the following. So first, we make the convergence analysis without forgetting factor. When there is a forgetting factor, basically there is no chance to prove anything because we will have a bias in our stochastic approximation. But we can hope that in practice it gives some interesting following of the statistics. Not converge to anything because the solution is changing. So we assume that there is no forgetting factor. We make some ergodicity assumption on the sequence HN, YN. And we only need, concerning the choice of the subspace, the gradient and the current point should be inside the subspace. So these are the convergence results we obtain. So first, we have the typical convergence result because we use the standard recursive updates for rho n and rn and small rn. So we have the convergence of these sequences. And we have the convergence. So remember that we are in the non-convex case. So this was quite challenging. We have in the non-convex case that the set of cluster points is compact. And any element of this set is a critical point. So this is for non-convex. And in the convex case, we have the convergence of the sequence to the global minimizer for this algorithm. We also make the convergence rate analysis of this stochastic algorithm. So what is interesting in this result is that we obtain some worst and best case bounds for the convergence rate of the algorithm, and we can see that these bounds depends on two quantities. It depends on this ratio, which is basically the conditioning of the Hessian of F, and it depends on another ratio, which is here, which corresponds to how well the quadratic majorization approximates the second order Taylor expansion. So it's kind of logic that we recover this kind of quantities in the convergence rate. And if we study a bit more the proof behind these bounds, we observe that the slow convergence is obtained using the gradient subspace. What does it mean? It means that in your subspace, you only put the gradient direction. So then the algorithm is very similar to the stochastic gradient descent. In that case, we obtain the slowest rate. And the fastest rate is obtained for the full subspace. We are using all Rn. The problem is that we lose in terms of complexity, because here again, we need to invert this n by n matrix. So in the full subspace, we are very close to some kind of stochastic Newton algorithm. And from this convergence in the stochastic case, we deduce the convergence rate analysis for the batch case, which was not available before. And this is what we obtain. So basically, we obtain quite a similar convergence analysis that for standard descent algorithm. And here again, we can see that we have some constants, so it's not written here, but kappa max, again, depends on the ratio between the Hessian and the majorant curvature. And in the strong convex case, we obtain the linear convergence of the sequence with the rate depending on the strong convexity constant. So I will finish by presenting an application of this algorithm in the context of filter identification. So it's not really an inverse problem in the sense that we know the original image, we know the degraded image, but we want to estimate the degradation operator. So what could be the application? There is an important application in, again, in the context of microscopy when you want to estimate the point spread function of a microscope. Typically, you will take the image of some beads. So you know what should be the original image, basically some kind of Dirac. You see what is the observed beads in the microscope, and using this filter identification, you can deduce the model of the point spread of the point spread function. So this is the context of this this problem. And of course, here we concentrate on the case when the image is very large, in the sense that we consider that at each iteration, we will only look at a patch within this image, and we will look different patch at different iterations, and we hope to converge to the true the true degraded operator, degradation operator. So this was for the result. So this was the blur we have modeled. So it's some kind of motion blur. We have a good estimation results. And these are the convergence curves. So I plot the relative error with respect to time for different methods. So in black, we have our method, S2MG. So we compare with the standard stochastic gradient descent, which is quite slow. It's in red. And with two more recent stochastic optimization methods from machine learning community, so the SAGA method from De Fazio, and the regularized dual averaging from Frank Xiao. And in this particular problem, we can see that both all these three methods perform quite quite poorly with respect to the to S3MG. And the main difficulty in this method was the setting of the step size, because in a stochastic optimization algorithm, the algorithms are very sensitive to the choice of the step size, or called also the learning rate. So basically, if you choose it too small, the method can be extremely slow. And if you choose it too big, the method can diverge. So we really need to set this manually. And the advantage of the MM framework is that you have a closed form formula for this step size, at least here for the quadratic loss. And here, so we can see that we have a faster convergence. We make also some study on the performance of the method depending on the size of the patch we select at each iteration of the method. So we, this is what could be expected. If we select a very small patch, Q times 8 times H, which is even smaller than the blur we are looking for, we have a very slow convergence. For very large size patch, we do not have a good compromise in terms of complexity, and the best compromise is obtained in this case for 256 times 256, knowing that it certainly highly depends on the computer used for the simulation. The advantage is that here we are quite flexible, and we have convergence for any size of the block, or the what is also called the mini batch size. And another to finish, another comparison between the 3MG subspace and the other subspace. Remember, I show a table. We can also choose this and this subspace. We made some comparison with the gradient subspace, which was proved to be related to the slowest convergence rate. So this is confirmed. This is the curve in red. So we can see that we have a very slow, a much slower convergence. What is great is that it's slow, but it's still faster than the standard SGD. So just using this MM step size in the SGD really improves the convergence. The memory gradient subspace, it's in black, and we also compare when we add more memory in the subspace, and actually it doesn't bring anything, and we even have a bit slower convergence. So this is really the optimal choice, it seems, in practice, to take only gradient plus this momentum direction. So I will conclude my talk. So I present a framework to solve in an efficient manner differentiable optimization problems. arising in inverse problems in image signal processing, but this type of problems can also arise in other applications, especially in supervised classification. So I present two extensions of the SWEMG approach. First, the block parallel SWEMG algorithm, which is based on a section of the block at each iteration and which allows to use a parallel computation device. And second, a stochastic SWEMG algorithm for quadratic loss. The big advantage, to my view, is no need for tuning up step size. So this is very interesting in the context of stochastic optimization. We can have, through this forgetting factor, I did not show some results, but we really have some nice practical results in the adaptive context when we have some changes in the data, and we have some convergence guarantees. So there are many future work to do, because we need to first to extend this stochastic SWEMG to non-quadratic loss. It will be very useful. And we have to perform the full convergence analysis of the block parallel SWEMG, especially in the non-convex setting, as it was done for the SWEMG. So I'm giving you the references associated to this talk, and I thank you for your attention.
Questions for Emily?
In the second part of your talk, where you were talking about, actually you cared about the block diagonality of matrix A in order to be able to solve the problem in parallel manner. I was wondering why you don't care about the separability of other terms, for example, f of hx or the function psi s that you had a kind of summation on that function.
So actually, yeah, of course, the separability of f or the different terms will be a very good point to help us to parallelize the algorithm. So here we really make the choice not to make any separability assumption on the function itself, mainly because it was not satisfied in the application we have. Typically, in image restoration, we have some connection between pixels in the regularization terms and in the data fidelity terms. So we do not really have this separability assumption. We have some kind of connectivity graph within the variable, and so we choose to make the assumption on the majorant function, because this is just a construction in the algorithm.
So you mean you can we can use your method even if those functions are not separable?
Exactly, yeah.
Thank you.
Of course, I would say, so they do not need to be separable, but you know, there is this sharing operation. So it will always be better in terms of complexity and efficiency on parallel architecture if the functions are separable or almost separable, meaning that we have only local interaction. If we have completely fully connected say graph within the cost function, it will be very efficient.
Other questions? Yep.
I have a question about on the page 17 or 18, it's about the numerical test for different problem L2, L1, L2, L0. And you use
this one?
Yeah, this one. So in this numerical test, the SNR is fixed because it is the SNR.
Mm-hmm. And this is the output.
Output SNR.
So the input SNR is fixed, so it's 15. So
okay.
the noisy data is fixed, and this is the output SNR. So it changes depending on the penalty function which is used. Basically, for convex, for L2, L1, we obtain something like 20.4, and for the non-convex, we have 22.7. For the output.
Okay, but for the non-convex case, the SNR is all the same. It means all the algorithm is converged to the same solution.
So what happens in practice is that the solution is not exactly the same. When we look at the cost function, we can also have some differences. So it means that we do obtain local minima, but in this particular case, we say local minima or seems to be all good in terms of all good and similar in terms of image restoration. But this is on this specific case, in the sense that we do not prove any global convergence property in the non-convex case.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, any other question? Guillaume, t'as pas le micro, deuxième micro, non? Ah.
The subspace acceleration, where you choose the subspace to be a span of the gradient at that point and the memory vector in some sense. What was the intuition behind choosing the memory vector? And if you had, let's say, an estimate of the inverse of the Hessian, would e-multiplying the memory vector by that be useful in any way?
Yeah, so first, the intuition behind this choose was a preliminary work which shows that the MM algorithm can be applied to choose a step size in the nonlinear conjugate gradient algorithm. And then we realized that in the nonlinear conjugate gradient algorithm, we have this memory term and this conjugacy term. So we say, why not estimating both conjugacy term and step size? So this was the main reason. And we also observed that NLCG was quite efficient in practice in the type of problems we were working on. And the second point, I totally agree. So we make some... so this is very important not to be stuck to the gradient direction, and any preconditioned direction or any Newton-like direction can be very efficient. It highly depends on the problem, but we have seen some application when we can really improve the convergence speed by changing this gradient by gradients times approximation of the Hessian. And actually, it does not change the convergence properties. Actually, what we have is that we should have in our direction what we call the gradient-related direction. So it's not necessarily exactly the gradient, but the gradient time symmetric positive definite matrix will make the work perfectly well.
Okay, so if there's no more questions, we can thank Emily for her talk.